Hey guys, today we're going to be talking about my September favorites. I've got a lot of stuff. I have a lot of makeup. I feel like I've been reviewing a lot this past month. I also have some brushes to talk about, and I have a hair tool. And if you guys watch my vlog, you know exactly what I'm going to be talking about. So let's start there. I have been loving the GHD Rise. This hair tool, dare I say, has been a complete, sorry, there's hair on there, has been a total and complete game changer for me. So before this came into my life, I tried a curling wand, I didn't really like it, and then I used a curling iron, you know, just like a regular one with a clamp on it, like a 1.5 inch barrel, and I would use that and kind of curl the ends of my hair. And I would do it and the result was always okay, but I was never thrilled with it. And I realized what I didn't like about it so much was that the curls just always seemed so uniform and they were just a little bit too ringlety for me. I didn't really like that very prominent kind of curl, and I just wanted a little bit more body, a little bit more motion, a little bit of wave, but nothing too like pronounced curl. And I saw a bunch of YouTubers actually use this, and most of them I think are in the UK. But anyway, this GHD Rise is so good. I actually, and I'm not a hair person, but I have been looking forward to styling my hair ever since I got this. So what I do is I just blow dry my hair with like a big brush. I want to get as much moisture out as possible. And then I use this, and this has the fastest like warm-up situation. It's also super simple. There's no temperature control or this and that. It's just an on-off button and that's it. And the whole barrel heats up. It's got these teeth around here, as you guys can see. And it's just so easy. The teeth help hold the hair in place a little bit, but not completely. It's not as harsh as like a clamp on a curling iron. And so I feel like it's got to be the brushing action as you kind of run this through your hair, as you're curling it, that kind of keeps it from being too curly. And I just love the result. Like, this is perfect for me. Just a little bit of wave, nothing too crazy again, and it's so, so easy to use. This I find to be easier to use than a curling wand, which I always burn myself on, or a curling iron where I feel like, you know, I'm always kind of playing with the clamp and trying to run it down like the length of my hair. This just makes it so easy. I kind of hold it in the way you would a curling wand, but because these teeth are there, like it definitely gets warm, but the teeth prevent me from actually like burning myself, because you can't actually, well you can, but you know, you can't easily reach into like the heated part of the barrel. And then this end is something you can hold onto. It definitely gets very warm, and if you hold it too close to the barrel, it gets very, very hot. So definitely if you wanna kind of hold onto this end, you wanna hold onto the tip of it, and it's just easy. I just section out my hair, I curl it pretty much all in one direction. I probably curl one or two strands like in the different direction, you know, kind of like going towards me instead of going away. And like I said before, until I got this, I have never, ever looked forward to doing my hair. I would just kind of blow dry it, you know, big brush it or whatever. And now I really look forward to doing my hair with this. And it doesn't take that much time. I want to say it takes me, I mean, maybe a total of 10 minutes to go through this. And I am like not good at my hair at all. I think if you're someone who's used to kind of curling your hair, you could probably do it much faster. It's great. And I just love the result. And the other thing that I was kind of worried about, because I thought, oh, these are such soft curls and I have such straight hair, that I thought for sure, like by the end of the day, you know, my hair would just kind of be straightened out or whatever. It's not. If I fall asleep with this hair, I will wake up with like the same amount of wave. I feel like when I've used a curling iron or a wand in the past, like there'll be a little bit left of it the next day, but it really doesn't look like it did much. I can't believe how my hair kind of like maintains its wave. And I don't know how a tool would actually change that. I just think that's really fascinating. So anyway, I have been loving this GHD Rise. Okay, next up, I wanna talk about foundations. This is definitely gonna be more of a roundup versus like my favorites, but I will talk about the ones that I've been reaching for the most, which I would consider my favorites. So I have really done a lot of foundation reviews, and I've really been trying to use different ones every day just to try and get like a better sense of each one and like the personality of each one. So I'm gonna start with the one that I have been reaching for the most, and I would have to say kind of ended up being my favorite out of all of these new ones over this past month, and that is the Kogan Doe Moisture Foundation. So I have two shades. I have shade 113, oops. I have shade 113 and 123, and 123 definitely is one that I will probably use if I'm self-tanning a little bit or, you know, during the summer months, but whatever color, if I had any color over the summer, it's completely faded by now. So I just have 113 all over my face, and I really love this foundation because it has really lovely coverage. It is definitely a light medium, very easily built to a medium. I almost feel like you could use two very light layers to achieve a medium coverage. But it doesn't look makeup-y, it doesn't look cakey. It looks so, so natural on my skin. And I had been sitting here, ever since I got this and kind of using it, I had been sitting here just kind of trying to figure out like which one I like better, this one or the Kogan Doe Aqua Foundation, which I think is probably one of their hero products, at least part of their makeup line. Most people I know of who have tried the Aqua Foundation really enjoy it. I think I like this one better. The Aqua Foundation has a much thinner texture, so it's very water-based. And the coverage is very, very similar, but I find that one, and this is strange coming from me because I have very dry sensitive skin and I generally opt for more radiant foundation. But that one is a little bit more radiant and I feel like I have to powder it. This foundation, I feel like I can powder it and it looks great. I don't have to powder it and it looks great. It just stays so consistent all day. I don't feel like the level of radiance or anything kind of changes throughout the day. And it's just so wonderful. It's just like a rock solid kind of foundation. I feel like it's very, very dependable. And Kogan Doe is a brand that was started, I believe, by an actress. And so it's meant to be used on a movie set. And so it just has like the most amazing longevity. And yeah, it's really, really perfect for my needs and what I'm looking for. And for someone who generally likes like a light medium coverage, this is something a little bit heavier. And even with that, I just don't feel like I'm wearing more makeup or makeup that's too cakey or anything like that. I just think it's really, really just like high quality stuff. And someone had mentioned the packaging, and that comment caught my eye because I kind of thought the same thing. I thought for such a lovely foundation for it to just be in this red plastic tube just didn't really appeal to me. But then, you know, it's like I have to remember that Kogan Doe really is for makeup artists, artists that are really on the go, artists that are on set. And so, you know, these aren't even artists that have like a trolley. These are artists that have to carry the stuff on them, on a belt, in a bag or whatever. And so it has to be easily recognizable. So the red is really handy for that. And it has to be light. And this is incredibly light packaging. I mean, it's very, very travel friendly. So anyway, this is probably my favorite foundation, like just overall foundation from the last month. The most recent foundation that I've been playing around with is the Kier Weiss Liquid Foundation. This is brand new to Kier Weiss. This foundation I just started playing with, so I hesitated and even talking about it in my favorites video, but I thought, well, let me just do kind of like a foundation roundup. And so I did want to talk about this one. So this foundation is very radiant. So I've used this twice now, and the first time I used it, I put a lot of oil down because that's how they suggested it. Well, they didn't suggest putting a lot of oil down, but they did suggest prepping your skin with the Kier Weiss Beautiful Oil. So I used the oil that I had out here that I've been using, which is the Chantecaille Rose de May oil, and I think I used a little bit too much. And that day, and that was the day that I, you know, filmed my full day wear test, this foundation was very, very radiant, and I felt like I had to set it down with some powder. And again, because I have dry skin, I really didn't mind it, but I was like, wow, this is really, really radiant, almost bordering on like I was looking a little bit oily. The powdering helped a lot, and after a pretty long wear test, I think that day I was very, very active, and I meant to do a check-in, and the day got away from me, and I had started wearing this foundation like really early in the morning, and it just lasted all day. And Kier Weiss is a 100% certified organic brand, And I feel like organic makeup, clean beauty has come such a long way. Even just a couple years ago, I feel like if I tried any of their makeup, it was almost like, well, they're organic. Like that was kind of the justification for poor wear or longevity, or if it just didn't perform as well. And this foundation is right up there with any other kind of foundation. And I jumped onto Akira Weiss like Zoom tutorial, and she was talking about this new liquid foundation. And she said that what she started with was skincare. What she wanted to do was actually create something that was skincare, that was good for your skin. And so there's a lot of properties in there. Of course, you can read up on it on her site. Of course, I'll link it down below. And what she did was once they kind of perfected the skincare, then she added pigment to make it a color makeup base. And so I thought that approach was really awesome. I really like the thought that she put into this liquid foundation. So this foundation I really like as well. I thought the longevity was really impressive, but it is fairly radiant. Even on the second time I used it, when I didn't put as much oil down, but I did put a little bit of oil down per their advice, it did feel very, and the word that Kira Weiss used was luminous. And so there definitely is a very luminous finish to this foundation. So I definitely don't mind that. And if I'm in the mood for that, this is definitely one that I wanna reach for. Unfortunately, this shade is not great for me. So this is the one, they sent this to me, by the way. This is the shade Feathery. And I definitely have to get a lighter shade, as you guys can see. It's a little bit deep for me, but it's really, really beautiful. And if you want something with a little bit of luminosity, a little bit of radiance, then definitely try out this foundation. I think there's 24 shades in total and it retails for $48. And then the Chanel Le Beige. So this is the Healthy Glow Foundation Hydration and Longwear. And I believe this is a reformulated version of a previous. And I never tried the previous one, so I don't have like a comparison. This foundation is very lovely. I expected this to have a little bit more luminosity, a little bit more radiance, almost like the Kira Weiss, because it is a healthy glow foundation. But this actually has a very skin-like finish, and it is quite lovely. It has a very light medium coverage, and I do enjoy this, but I think where this one falls short compared to the Kogan Doe and the Kira Weiss, and the next one I'm gonna talk to, is that I didn't find that this had the best longevity. I felt like after about, I'm trying to recall my wear test, I think maybe it was like 6 hours or so, I could definitely see it was wearing away like a little bit on my forehead, around my nose and everything. So this is really lovely, and I think this is a great kind of like just everyday casual kind of foundation if you just want to look a little bit more put together. At least if I want to look a little bit more put together and I just want like an easy foundation to throw on, this would definitely be one that I would reach for. I don't feel like I would necessarily need to then like put on like a full face of makeup per se. Like this doesn't have that much coverage where I feel like I need to bring back a lot of color, or, you know, this doesn't like blank out my face that much. And this also is a foundation, like unlike the Kira Weiss, I didn't feel like I needed to powder this one. So again, another good one if you just wanna throw on and maybe you have like a cream blush and you just wanna tap on and put some on your lips or something. I think this is great for that. So next up is the Clé de Peau Radiant Fluid Foundation Matte. I have it in the shade 020 and 010. I, again, have dry sensitive skin, and so I've always gravitated towards more luminescent, more radiant kinds of foundations, foundations with like light medium coverage. But this foundation, which does have definitely a matte finish and definitely has more of a medium coverage, I was so impressed with how lovely this made my skin. Now, by the end of the day, I definitely feel like I was looking like a teensy bit radiant, more radiant in my complexion, but it was still definitely matte in like the majority of my face. But I couldn't believe how like not drying this made my skin look, especially considering all, it seems like all of the other kind of like radiant matte or soft matte foundations that I've tried, have been trying, just end up looking incredibly dry on my skin. This wore really well, and while I haven't always been the biggest fan of like a matte finish, I've never been opposed to a matte finish. I just wanted one that didn't actually dry out my skin, and I think I've actually found it. I think this is the one. I'm so happy because, and I've mentioned this a couple of times, but I feel like with the fall coming, fall winter, for some reason, this fall winter, I don't know if it's like the cool tones that are coming out, I really am starting to feel like grungy Michelle coming back, and I want to do more like cool tone looks and like a matte foundation. I don't know. We'll see where the season takes us, but that's definitely what has been kind of going on in my brain. So this has definitely been a winner for me. And if you have dry skin and you are looking for a matte foundation, I would definitely give this a shot. I think if you can get to a counter, they'll probably give you some samples of this, but it's really, really lovely. So definitely recommend this one. And then last but not least, this is the last foundation that I wanted to talk about. This is the Suku, the cream foundation. So my shade has an SPF 25, and this is like a newly reformulated cream foundation of theirs. Another one that I didn't get to experience the previous version. But when I did a wear test of this, and I did a video on this, I used this in conjunction with their oil-rich loose powder, which is a loose powder that is infused with oils. It's great for dry skin, and it has this like almost like shimmer to it, almost like highlight kind of shimmer to it. And it's a gorgeous powder. But when I used that for the first time together with this, it ended up looking a little bit cakey. I think I used too much of that powder because I used this foundation again the next day without that powder. I used it actually with a powder that I'll talk about in just a second, but the Sisley powder, it looked so much better. It didn't look heavy and cakey on the skin. It's really quite lovely. And the cream of this foundation is not too oily. I didn't feel like I put it on and felt like I put like night cream on, and it wore really well. It lasted throughout the day. I want to say, you know, probably the only reason I'm not going to reach for this one as much as the others is because it comes in a jar, and some days I just don't want to mess with it. Some days I just want to squeeze it out of a tube or just, you know, pump it out of a pump. And I get why it's in a jar. It is a thick cream consistency. For me, it's just one of those things. Like I'll look at it and think, well, I'm in a rush. Let me go for something else. And that's not to say I don't love this foundation. So the shade that I got is shade 220. And I think if you have a similar skin tone to mine, you can definitely get this shade. It's very, very difficult to find the right shade, at least for me in Suku, because I feel like the numbering, it doesn't go in order just from like lightest to deepest. It's very unique. So anyway, I have shade 220. All right, those are all of the foundations. And if I had to pick a favorite, I think I said this in the beginning, it would be the Kogen Do Moisture Foundation. It's just the one that I've been reaching for the most, and I always consider those products to be favorites. All right, the next product is a concealer. This is the Chanel Longwear Concealer, I think that's the name. And I have it in shade 20 Beige. This is a concealer that I had, used plenty, loved it. And then I just, you know, de-stashed it because I had just had it for too long. And I just recently repurchased this and I love it. It has such a nice lightweight texture to it. I believe it's like gel based. And so it just blends in really quickly, really easily. I love the shade. It's just like a light neutral. And I just really prefer that. I can use ones that are a little bit of like a color corrector, like ones that maybe have like a little bit of peach in them or whatever. But I really prefer ones that are just kind of neutral. And it just does such a good job. You know, it's not super high coverage. I would say it's like a medium coverage in terms of a concealer. And it's just, you know, straightforward. There isn't any luminosity to it, but it's not dry looking. It stays put all day. It doesn't kind of change texture throughout the day. It doesn't end up looking dry or cakey. It doesn't sink into my fine lines or anything. I just really love it. So I'm so glad I repurchased this, and I've been going pretty hard with this guy. Next, powder. I love this Sisley pressed powder. This is their Fito Poudre Compact, and they sent over shade 2 Natural, which is what I use to kind of dust all over my face. Again, if you have a similar skin tone to mine, I would say this is the shade you should go for. It is very, very translucent. It's not like it's going to change your foundation shade necessarily, but there is a little bit of pigment there, as you can see, and I love the finish of it. It is like the most kind of like demi matte, demi satin kind of finish. It's so beautiful. It's just very natural, very skin-like, and it does such an amazing job blurring. I feel like it gives me this sort of like soft filter effect over my entire face, and I love it. I absolutely love it. So that is 2 Natural, and then they also sent over number 4 Bronze, which is what I've been using to bronze, and that's what I have on my face today. It's just a really soft, again, natural, kind of like neutral toned bronze. It blends in beautifully. You know, it's just all the right things. And now that we're kind of transitioning into fall, I'm moving further away from like my warm bronzers, my really kind of like golden toned bronzers. And this has been great. Just to add like a little bit of life to my face. It's been wonderful. So big, big fan of these Sisley powders. The next product is one that I've been talking about a lot. Why is that? Well, I did a video on it and then, oh, I did that Sephora like 10 fall products. And I had to mention this new Hourglass Ambient Edit Lighting Palette. What is this called? Ambient Lighting Edit Sculpture Palette. And every year I usually pick this palette up. And so far my favorite still is the Unlocked, which they came back out with as the Ghost, and now they have the Mini 4 Pan. The other ones have always been really nice. I've always liked the idea of them. This one, I definitely feel like I'm using the most. And it's probably because I like the bronzer in this one. Most Hourglass bronzers I've tried either have a little bit too much micro glitter in there, or the undertone is a little bit too warm. And this one seems to be the most neutral on my skin tone. So I've been loving that, and I've been using this cool tone blush, this Mood Exposure, a lot. And it's funny because I have this in a single pan, but for some reason I've been reaching for this palette to use this. But I've been loving this, and if you guys love Hourglass like powder products, this is absolutely no different. And I really appreciate that about Hourglass. When they come out with these Ambient Lighting Edit palettes, the quality is very consistent to their regular line, where I feel like, you know, some companies kind of cut corners when they come out with palettes with like a lot of different products in there, and it's only for the holidays or it's limited edition or whatever. But the quality of these Hourglass products, very on par with the rest of their products. And then one of the highlights I have been loving is the new Charlotte Tilbury Hollywood Superstar Glow Highlighter, the ultimate face and body highlighter for a soft focus glow. So this is new for the holidays. I don't know if this is limited edition or not, but it is a gigantic, gigantic highlighter. It is the same size as her bronzers. And so I was actually very surprised. I thought it was gonna be the same size as her blush, but no, this is like huge. The highlighter itself is gorgeous. And when I use this highlight in a trying new makeup video, I mentioned this and I'll mention it again. I thought that the highlight was going to be a little bit too deep for my skin tone because, can you see, it almost has like a cool undertone there, like almost like a gray undertone if you look at it in a certain light. And I thought, is this gonna look too deep on my skin tone? But I think it's great for my skin tone and like a little bit deeper, but it's such a pretty smooth highlight. And that's what I love about Charlotte Tilbury highlighters. All the ones that I've used either in the Instant palette or her baked ones that were in the like 4-pan palettes, or that single one she came out with, or the one in the Filmstar Bronze and Glow, they're all very, very smooth. And I appreciate that. Like there's no micro glitters in there. They're just like this beautiful satin sheen. And they're just gorgeous, absolutely gorgeous. So I've been loving this, and this is finally available on the Charlotte Tilbury site, which of course I'll link down below in my description box if you're interested. And then I did want to mention the Chanel Holiday Collection because it's so, so beautiful. So what I did today on my cheeks was I put the Hourglass Mood Exposure blush down for blush. I do have some of that Sisley bronzer down further down on my cheeks. And then I do have the Charlotte Tilbury, you know, highlight up there. So what I did was I applied the Chanel Holiday Illuminating Blush over that entire kind of like blush highlight area. And what I did was, and this is another favorite, I took the Sonia G Smooth Buffer Brush, which I can't put down. I feel like I just want to buff out my cheeks like all the time. I love the feeling, but I love the effect. So what I did was I picked up a little bit of this product on the brush and I just kind of slowly kind of buffed it in because the illumination in here is so beautiful. And I feel like if you just kind of like dust it over your cheeks, it just sort of sits like highlight, just kind of sits on top of your face. And I really like working it in so it really looks like a lit from within kind of effect. And I just love the effect. I love using this as like a little blush topper. And if it's a little bit deeper than what you're using, you can kind of focus it like further back on your cheek. I kind of put it all over, which is why I have a pretty strong cheek look today. But I just love the effect. I couldn't help myself. I just love the extra glow that I get by, you know, buffing it in with the smooth buffer. This is an awesome pair. The effect is so, so smooth. It's almost, or maybe it's like glass-like. Oh, it's just beautiful. And I cannot achieve this level of buffing without either Sonia G's Smooth Buffer, which I think is actually still in stock, surprise, surprise, or her Face One, which unfortunately is out of stock. This Smooth Buffer is just perfect for like this little cheek area when you just want to like really polish it up. Oh, it's so perfect. So the Smooth Buffer is a huge favorite. This Illuminating Blush is a huge favorite. And moving on to like eye favorites, I'm going to stick with the Chanel Holiday Collection. They came out with 4 Ombre Premier shadows, and this one I think is definitely the most special. I guess you could say this one is Couvre Rose, number 927. This is such a beautiful, like shimmery, slightly duochrome, like pink copper shade. And when I was first playing around with this, I thought this is kind of like a subdued version of like a Pat McGrath shadow. I feel like is exactly it. Like there's a little bit of micro glitter in there. The duochrome is pretty subtle, but it does remind me of a Pat McGrath shadow. It's probably the shade of it, but if you want something just a little bit more, I don't know, daytime appropriate, or you know, just something a little bit more subdued from the Pat McGrath shadows, like her baked shadows, you may want to try this one because it is really gorgeous, but it's just a little bit more subtle. So this is the one shadow that I've been reaching for a lot. The other 3 are beautiful as well, but this is like definitely the standout one. And then as for eyeshadow, I'm definitely moving into the cool toned thing and the Natasha Denona Glam Palette. I have been using this like non-stop all month. It is so beautiful, and I feel like every time I open this up, there's like another shade that I want to use, because generally I've been coming in here and just using one shade at a time, maybe 2, just like a lighter one in the inner corner area and then a deeper one on the outer area, and just kind of blending the two. Actually what I did today, but I used different shadows, which I'll get to, but I just love these shades. I love the formula. There really isn't much more to say other than if you like this color story, I definitely recommend this. The metallic shades are so smooth. They're really, really buttery, and the mattes really pigmented. I mean, they're very typical Natasha Denona shadows, but I find this palette to be probably her most consistent, and it's probably because she doesn't use that many different formulas in here. The majority of them are mattes, her creamy mattes and her metallics, and I think maybe there's one chroma crystal, this inner corner one up here. So they're just very consistent. They're just easy to use. This color story is absolutely gorgeous. I think if you have fair skin all the way up to a deep skin tone, you can use this palette. And I have just had this like just out on my vanity, and I've just been picking up and using it nearly every day. A more neutral palette that I have been really enjoying is this new Quint from Dior, and this is Soft Cashmere, number 669. These new Quints from Dior are mind-blowing. They are so, so beautiful. This one shade up in here is definitely the one that I've been kind of going for every time I open up this Quint, but it has such a gorgeous like wet effect, and it's taupey. There's like a little bit of like a pinkiness in there. It is, oh, it is so, so beautiful. It works really well with all of the other shades in here. If you want to put this on the majority of your lid, line your eyes with this, deepen it up a little bit with this one in the lower left-hand corner. It's just such a gorgeous Quint. I love this one, and I really love all of the Quints that I've picked up so far. And Dior was actually kind enough in sending me a whole bunch of other ones that I hadn't gotten a chance to pick up yet. So I would like to do a video with just all of the ones I have. At this point, I think I have like 11 of them. So if you would like a video just swatching all of them and kind of talking about all of them, I can try and do a look with all of them. Please let me know if you'd be interested in that down below in my comment section, because these Quints are just outstanding. So anyway, so far the one I've been reaching for the most is Soft Cashmere. And then the last eyeshadow I want to mention, sorry, I know this is a very long favorites, is this duo from Chantecaille. So this is one of their like chrome luxe eye duos, and this is in the shade Piazza San Marco. I have been going really, really hard with Tibet, which is more neutral, and oh my gosh, I can't remember the name. It's the more peachy duo, and that love for like the spring, summertime. It was just perfect, super easy. I love that these are duos, but now with the fall, winter, and like I keep saying, these cool tones are just really calling to me. I've just been loving this one. I mean, talk about an easy, pretty eye look. I just put the lighter shade on the inner corner, the deeper shade on the outer corner, and that's it, and I just blend. Even though it's very, very shimmery, I feel very comfortable wearing it during the day. I feel comfortable wearing it at night, if I go out to dinner or something. This is like the perfect look for me. It's just easy and not fussy, and been loving it. Been absolutely loving it. So that is the Piazza San Marco shade. And oh, I didn't realize that, but each actual shade is named. So the deeper shade is Pigeon, and then the lighter shade is Marble. Oh, who knew? It's on the back there. All right, and in an incredibly strange turn of events, I have three mascaras to talk about. It has been like mascara bonanza. I think before foundation bonanza, it was mascara bonanza. And these are the three that I've been reaching for the most. Most recently, the Surratt Noir Lash Tint. That's what I have on. I just love it. I love how easy it is to apply because this is that mascara with no brush. It just has, basically it's like a screw end. It has threading along the end. And boy, was I skeptical about this. I was like, is this a gimmick? But it puts mascara on so easily. And now that I've really gotten the hang of it, I feel like it lengthens my lashes, and I love how it makes my lashes just very separated. They're not clumpy. It's not this sort of like extreme volume where, you know, you look like you have fake lashes on or anything. It's just a great everyday kind of like elegant lash look, and loving it. The only downside, and it's not even really a downside, but it is a little bit difficult to get off. I'm used to being able to just use like my Kogan Doe cleansing spa water and then double cleanse with my Retrouvé Luminous Cleansing Elixir, but I have to go in with like an oil-based like biphasal makeup remover and like leave the cotton pad, you know, on my eyes, and then it comes right off. But I'm not used to having to do that. So this definitely is a little bit more of a stubborn mascara to remove, but I would say that's the only like kind of downside to this mascara. And then the other mascara that I love that kind of has a similar effect to this Surratt one is the M Cosmetics one. I think I've mentioned this before, but this is like the pick me up lashes. I can't remember the full name, but this has a very wet kind of formula. It holds my curl really well. It lengthens my lashes and it separates them. But what's cool about this mascara in opposition to the Surratt is that it comes off very easily because it's like a tubing mascara. So the mascara just kind of like flakes off. It comes off really easily, which I appreciate, especially after a long day. So that's the M mascara. And then last but not least is the NARS Climax Extreme Mascara. This mascara is like completely different from those two mascaras in that this gives you like a lot of volume and fluffiness and length, and it actually keeps my lashes curled all day. Usually with volume mascaras, I don't really get like the curl. Usually the curl kind of comes with like these lengthening, separating kind of mascaras, at least in my experience. But this mascara kind of does it all. But the trick with this mascara, at least for me, is that I have to wipe the wand off. I feel like if I start off with too much product, it gets a little clumpy and it's just too much to work through. So I like using a lot of like light layers with the mascara, like building it up slowly, and that's when I feel like I get like the best kind of like volume fluffiness with this mascara. So that would be my little bit of advice with this mascara, is just like kind of build on it and wipe off the brush before you go in. And the next product is something I've been meaning to talk about, but I forgot in last month's favorites. I think it's because it's such a utilitarian product, but these are the Wayne Goss Essential Eye Kohl Pencils. I love these mainly because they're Kohl and not gel. For me, at least, Kohl goes on just a lot easier and it doesn't feel as thick as gel eyeliner. I feel like if I use gel eyeliner in my waterline, I can kind of feel it. Or if I even like kind of work it into like my lash line, I just feel like I can feel that eyeliner. Where Kohl eyeliners, I feel like are just a little bit, they like kind of glide on a little bit easier and they're just not as thick. And once these eyeliners like set down, they do not smudge. probably takes a little bit longer for these to set down than a gel eyeliner, but I kind of like that too because you can kind of like work it out and smudge it if you want to like do a smoky eye or something. And I love all three colors that he came out with. They're basics for sure, but Obsidian is what I have on. It's just a black. He has Rich Hazel, which is just a brown. And then there's the third one, which is like pearly something. Anyway, that one is like a deep brown, but there's like a little bit of a metallic finish to that one. I love that one. That one I was using a lot when I first got these. And this Obsidian is definitely one that I've been using a little bit more because of like the cooler eye looks that I've been doing. So I've been using these a lot. And more recently, I've been using it in conjunction with this brush. This is another brush I wanted to mention. This is a Bristles Beauty brush. This is the E04RS. And this is like a smudger brush. But for some reason, and I've been, you know, comparing this with like other smudger brushes that I have, I think because this one's just a little bit wider, it just makes it faster and easier to kind of smudge things out. But what I like to do occasionally with the eyeliner is I will just take the smudger brush, run it across the eyeliner, and like work it into my lash line. And this one has been great. It's very firm, but there's like that little bit of wiggle. This Bristles Beauty brush is just really great. I'm enjoying all of their brushes, but this one I've been reaching for a lot. So it's E04RS. All right, and some lip products. Whew, okay, we're getting to the end here. The Chanel Holiday Collection, just to go back to that for a second, they came out with four Rouge Allure lipsticks, and this Orb Beige is number 107, and it is so beautiful. It's what I have on my lips today. It is a little bit on the peachier side than the mood that I've been in, but I can't stop wearing it because it has that little bit of gold finish to it, and it's just so gorgeous. And I feel like it works okay with like a cooler eye look. I don't think it looks like strange at all is what I'm trying to say. So even though this definitely leans a little bit warm, I feel like it kind of behaves in a neutral way, and I can wear it with warm and cool eye looks. So I've been loving this, and you know, the Chanel Rouge Allure formula is wonderful. It's very pigmented, very smooth, and very comfortable on the lips. And you know, it's not a long wearing lipstick or anything like that, but I don't feel like when I wear it, I'm like constantly applying it or constantly feeling like I have to apply it. So there's a decent amount of longevity with these Rouge Allures. And then I've also been loving the Tower 28 Milky Shine On Lip Jellies. So they came out with four new colors. They are, I want to say, kind of neutral, cool toned. And I wanted to just highlight one color for you instead of talking about all of them. So I picked Almond because this is definitely the one I've been reaching for the most, I would say. And it's what I have kind of layered on top of the Orb Beige. And I just love these Tower 28 lip jellies. They're really comfortable. I love all the shades that they've come out with. This Almond, like I said, is just the one that I've been reaching for a little bit more than the others, but it's really comfortable. It just makes my, you know, lips look a little bit juicier than they are in reality. So I've been really enjoying these milky ones, and the Almond color is definitely the one that I've been reaching for the most. All right, those are my September favorites. If you are still with me, thank you. Thank you so much for watching. Let me know what some of your favorites are down below in the comment section. Give this video a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Subscribe down below if you haven't already, and I'll see you in my next video.